the director of the Center for Virology and Vaccine Research, affiliated to Harvard University. He is also the director of Harvard Center for AIDS Research Advanced Lab Technologies Corps. He holds the distinguished position of Associate Professor of Medicine at the Harvard Medical School, as well as concurrently holds the position of Adjunct Associate Assistant Professor of Medicine at Emory University. He received his Ph.D. in microbiology from the University of Alabama, followed by postdoctoral training at the New England Climate Research Center of Harvard Medical School. So his lab focuses primarily on the role of natural killer cells in modulating HIV and SIV disease, as well as other viruses, such as hepatitis C and CMV. His lab has identified novel subpopulations of mucosal NK cells, and he is actually the first to identify evidence of NK cell memory in any primate species. He's author of hundreds of articles in high-impact journals, and he's a very prominent speaker at both national and international scientific conferences in his field. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Chase.
Can you guys hear me with this? I think I screwed up the mic. But anyway, so thank you for the very kind introduction. I certainly appreciate the invitation to kind of share some of my recent data on Innate, as well as what you're doing on so-called antigen-specific memory in T-cells, which just a few years ago would have been considered total nonsense, but I'm hoping that I can convince you through this process that what we used to think was really an innate population actually can have a different as well. And so just a little teaser for the talk, which I think will come up at multiple points in the course of the slide, is that many of these responses, even though they are specific to HIV infection, they're really driven by a contract infection of the immune system. So that's an important thing to think about. All right, so maybe just to start, a simplified view of NK cells, first described in the early 1970s, large non-T, non-B granular set of lymphocytes. In humans, we find two primary NK cells in the CD56 white population here, primarily the regulatory cytokine producing cells. And then you have the dominant population that we typically see in the lung, which is the C16 5-0 side of the cells. And these are what we find most in the lung. And prevailing theory is that the 56 white tends to differentiate into the CD16, and that's something else that's coming in the book of the book. So again, speaking with sort of a simplified view of NK cell recognition of virus-infected tumor cells, we think of NK cells as operating with this T-signal killing hypothesis. And basically what this is you have an activating inhibitory receptor that binds to cognate ligands, and then this, particularly the lack of inhibitory signal, is what actually triggers killing for NK cells. So it's this combination of signals. It's not a positive signal necessarily like we think of T cells, but it's usually the lack of the inhibitory signal that's really triggered to cells. Anyway, as I said, that's sort of the T-signal hypothesis, which is really simplified, but one thing I want to convince you as we go through is what I like to think of as the reality hypothesis. And what this shows is that NK cell interaction with a target cell is actually an integration of hundreds, or not hundreds, sorry, dozens of hundreds, of inhibitory and activating signals. And this really reveals the high complexity of this hypothesis that's not really just two signals, such that you must have 60% of your activating signal go forward, and that is sufficient to trigger a tail, or you could have 60% lacking into the first signal in that one. So since much of my research is actually conducted in HIV-infected disease attacks, it's important to say, based off of the simplistic definition of NK cells are shown in humans, what do NK cells look like in disease attacks? This is what we're really going to talk about for most of this presentation. So this is a very simplistic breakdown of what cells are conjugating. So this here, those are the city cells, the last thing you've seen, generally speaking. The omega CD3 as well as CD20 and CD16. But high levels of CD8 alpha as well as various influence on the cell receptors, CD46 and CD30, plus lots of neurons in feedback, and high levels of management. And then, unlike what we see in humans, you actually have a breakdown by the 56 versus 16, slightly different. You have a bright 56 positive population, but the CD16 dominant population in blood don't really show 56 at all, and then there is an unusual double negative population, which does not have an analogous counterpart, at least before the end of the of course, the question I ask is that we're trying to extrapolate understanding of human infertility from these research studies. So are human and metastasis cells functioning enough to really care about the phenotype that we suspect, but do they function as well? And it turns out they do. So this is a fugitive of our type of work. But even though they may look a little bit different, the 56 bright in both metastasis and humans, both regulatory and cells, both produce lots of cytokines, which is 16 positive cytokine letters, and that's regulating the same toxic function for which we're most familiar. Now, this is just sort of giving a very simplistic view of what infusions do, what they look like, how they function, but how do specifically infuse each of these infusions? So, let's go through this. So, there's really three primary mechanisms. You're probably familiar with some of them. The first is activation. I can say DPD induced stress function. Now, these can be upregulated on cancer cells, they can be upregulated just on stress cells. That may be dying with some of the product, and those are well characterized. Those are the answer 3, misdemeanor 2. The second is the engagement of T cell expressed tears, telomere-bonding receptors. Those engage with the intra-expressed potential target cells. And whether it's an inhibitory signal or an activating signal, you can have both types of tears. And whether or not peptide is actually presented in the groove can further modulate this. And then the third, which I'll spend a fair amount of time talking about today, is also in case of cooperation with the chemo response, the effusive tumor, mediated antibody-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity, again, which is, of course, where they're connecting with antibodies and growing antigen specificity in this way. So, do these phenomena actually then associated with alteration of the tumor disease progression? Well, in fact, they have. A lot of this work, first came out of Mary Kansas' lab. She was able to show specific cure repertoires are actually associated with the cure of and disease prevention, and this has been shown a number of years. But it has to be in the presence, or at least with a significant influence in the presence, of the appropriate HLA. And one thing that I think has also been an extremely important push to the field is that I believe also in Marcus Alford, also able to show several years ago, that HIV will use it to escape HLA mediated immune pressure. These are major hits to virus fitness and reputation, suggesting that T cells must be important to doing something concerning the virus, which is willing to take a good place to your food place. So, similarly, EDTC as a function has been shown to control mother child transmission and reduce mortality when the mother's vaccinated antibodies and antibody toxicity is in place. And also, ADCC has been shown to correlate. Of protection induced by light accumulated cells. So I think that's kind of a nice opening to the next component, which will really just be a review of some of the public studies and what we really learned about in T cells and interactions with membranes, particularly SIV, and how that's all been done in SIV infection, and how that really influences what we know about HIV interaction within T cells. So first, just sort of a macro level, what does SIV do to increase all these cells from a 50-factor cell? Well, the first thing you see is that in infected animals, these are all chronically infected, you see an expansion of the total infection. You can see that. You also see a specific expansion of those CFAR cytotoxic infections. Now, this is not necessarily surprising. And then I didn't go into the specifics, but you also see an expansion of the double negative subset of NK cells, which are also cytotoxic. So what this sort of suggests to us, just at the cellular number level, you're getting an expansion of the cytotoxic in the T-cell repertoire. But what if you look at that simple ICS? Well, in fact, what we've seen is that in chronic SIV infection, NK cells, which are all subsets, down-regulate production of cytokines. Other than antiviral cytokines, or even antiviral cytokines, infant gamma, mifflin beta, DC, circuitry, and regulation of the cell. But what you see instead is an upregulation of a surrogate marker, C1-7A, suggesting that there is a female cytotoxic in their function. And if you go further beyond that, and you look at intracellular expression of perfumes and brain enzymes, it's exactly what you see. So we know that the general repertoire of an infant of these infections shift from the regulatory cytokine-producing cells be expanded, but it's also numbers and a state. So that's talking about NK cells just in peripheral blood, getting this expansion of these cytotoxic cells, where they go. Well, one thing that we know about NK cells in general is they traffic very specific to subpopulations. So we've got two surrogate markers for trafficking. CCR7, surrogate marker for lymph node homing. Alpha-4 beta-7, a surrogate marker for homing to the gut. And you can see CD16 positive tend to traffic to the gut at much higher levels than other subpopulations, and they don't tend to go into the lymph node. Now, in SID inspection, you see a further upregulation of alpha-4 beta-7 on the CD16 cytotoxic cell. But even beyond that, you see a shift from CCR7 expression to alpha-4 beta-7 expression in both the 56 positive and the double negative, suggesting that we're moving all of these cytotoxic cells away from the lymph node to homing to the gut. Which kind of makes sense if you think about it, because there's a lot of the action that we can do in place to reach through. So once we're getting all these NK cells to the nucleus site, what happens once they get there? Well, one of the first things you see, not necessarily all the time, surprisingly, is that there's a massive increase in time. And what that's really indicative of when NK cells are coming over is that they're doing something. They're killing them. And so, further beyond that, you see that the NK cells are chronically hypersomatotic. Again, same thing that we see in peripheral blood. They're down-regulating production of NK-gamma, NK-alpha, other cytokines, upregulating cytotoxic functions. And basically what this results in is that you may be having lysis of infected cells in the GI tract, but you're also increasing the inflammation in bystander cell death. So sometimes it's difficult to tease out whether NK cells are pathogenic or potentially beneficial. And so not to forget about lymph nodes, even though they're trafficking away from them, there are still NK cells in the lymph nodes. And so I think it's very important to think about, well, what's happening to the NK cells that manage to hang out in the lymph nodes? And so what we find, and I won't go through how many details on this, but it's actually a very interesting phenomenon, is that the NK cells that remain in the lymph nodes tend to be sort of cytokine-producing, regulatory, chemical NK cells. They give the inflammation caused by HIV-SIV, they differentiate inside into cytotoxic NK cells, that they become exhausted as soon as they're processed. So again, the whole theme is that the whole body is untreated in this particular context. Everything is shifting toward a cytotoxic phenotype during phase one. And sometimes to the detriment, because you may be getting a bystander damage in the GI tract, and then you also end up with chronically exhausted in phase one. So just a little aside from that, this is a little snippet from a study that Lewis Trigger had done a number of years ago, where we identified a potential reservoir for latent HIV infected cells within the B-cell follicle of the muscle. And I think for the most part, this has come to be pretty well accepted, and clearly it's not the only place that we have. And so we started a study just a few years ago, primarily done by Michaela Mueller at the CFAR Institute, where they were able to show that in a non-pathogenic natural pathogenic monkeys, NK cells could actually infiltrate into the lymph node follicles of the species and clear them. Now, this doesn't happen in these sort of cats, and it doesn't happen in humans. It's highly dependent on lymph node pathogen, as well as an upregulation of the NK cell. Receptor needed to infiltrate the follicles, and that is CFAR. So I think that this presents a sort of a unique opportunity. So this is happening in a non-pathogenic host. If we could figure out ways to make this happen in an HIV-infected subject or in an HIV-infected subject, I think we'd be able to know. So again, just to sort of summarize all that portion up, infection, HIV or HIV drives differentiation from cytokine-producing regulatory NK, which is those here on the left, 56 positive, to the intermediate double negative, and down-regulates cytokine production, and up-regulates cytotoxicity, and at the end of that, it drives you fully to an outlet NK cell population. So if you could rest it here, or go back to the balance that you had before, that would be the goal. And that's sort of one of the goals that we have in that study in the field. If you want to either never get to this point or be able to. And so just to sort of reinforce this, we can actually even look at complex gene sets, and you can even see these differentials in the frame that we're looking at. So if you take all these different populations, you quantify by RNA-seq or whatever method you want to use, all the different genes that may be modulated, cytokine-producing, cytotoxic genes, you can actually see that too. You can have the undifferentiated cytokine-producing mutations here on a PCA plot. Those are intermediate or partially cytotoxic, very cytotoxic, potentially the cytotoxic. So this is something that we've worked on for a number of years. I think this is pretty much the same. Sort of an accepted paradigm for what happens to the cells. I always just like to say, we're going to go through each of these topics, but you know, sometimes they give us grief about doing the studies in non-human primates as opposed to humans, but I think that I wanted to highlight a couple of instances where the monkeys definitely told us first, and they told us correctly. Regular phone, increased cytotoxicity, coupled with decreased cytokine production, increased inflammatory gut trafficking, bystander liver damage, which I'm going to go into, and increased cell-associated bone marrow damage, as well as the cytokine differentiation and clinical quality. But all of these are shown in monkeys first, but it's not in concern in human studies. Okay. So that really sums up kind of the crash course of what NK cells are doing in each of the aspects of infection and what we've learned there. But this has all been referring to classic typical innate NK cells that we think of, that we typically think of in the normal way. And so we always want to ask the question, could we be missing something beyond the typical type of NK cells? And so what that brought us to is what would have been considered immunologic heresy, total nonsense, just a few years ago. And that would be NK cell memory. And I think some people may still think it's nonsense, but I think particularly for those in the NK field, it's actually burdened into such a large research field. When you say NK memory, you actually have to clarify what type of NK memory you're referring to because it's become so common. So I'll just touch on each of these briefly and I'll go through each of them in detail. So the first cytokine-induced memory NK cells, exactly what you think it is. Recall sensitization to specific pathogens or antigen-induced cytokine signature. And so what that means is that each individual pathogen creates a specific complex array of quantities and qualities of the cytokines, and then the immune system recognizes that same signature as it comes apart again, and those NK cells have been encountered to itself. The second, is what we call evolved NK cell memory. And this is the one that was actually first described. And this is specific receptors and encoders recognize individual pathogens or antigens that are encoded in the germline and the same receptor appears over and over and over again. But this is not something that diversifies the T cell or B cell receptor, but it is specifically evolved from one pathogen. The third are memory-like NK cells. These are what we think are epigenetically modified NK cells that can rapidly be recalled following an initial pathogen. But they're called memory-like because even though they have these epigenetic changes for rapid recall, they function through ADCC and they still require antibodies to their antigen sensitivity. And then finally, which I think is what most of the most interested in and has been the toughest to study, are the true antigen-specific NK cells. So now that it's non-native antigens seem to be germline encoded and you have rearrangements just like you see for T cell and a B cell. But then this is probably when we started to do this. Okay, so again, just to go through each of these in a bit more detail, I think we'll touch on this one next, so I won't do too much. But again, cytokine-induced memory, maybe just dive into clarify it a bit. Again, pre-sensitized to different cytokine signatures. This induces the cytokine production by the NK cells, typically answering the gamma more than anything else, also increases cell toxicity, and also causes them to proliferate and disseminate. But anyway, as I mentioned before, once these NK cells that have been encoded in this way come upon that same cytokine signature again, they become rapidly responsive and can mobilize much more quickly to that particular pattern. But an important distinction for this is that they don't seem to have the capacity for traditional antigen sensitivity. The second is evolved NK cell memory. I mentioned this is the one that we really learned about first. This is pre-sensitized, transferable memory. It's been shown to be protected, completely protected against a lethal neuroinflammation. And really, the only thing that evolving facial memory has been clearly shown for is in CMV. And it's presumed to have evolved, of course, the type of what is called CMV. But it also plays a role, I think, in increasing education. Some of the data there is still being used. But the one thing that is very important to think about this is it's very specific to individual receptors. Unlike 49H, is a receptor in mice that is tons expressed on NK cells, and it binds to neuroinflammatory M157. That's the only thing it will bind to clearly, and you get that response, and you get cytokine. And so we also see something similar happening in humans, mediated by HKG2C5 mutations. But at least at the time when these were initially being published, the receptors that HKG2C5 could bind to were really completely unknown. But this actually came out just this year that we have been able to identify at least one protein, which is, that the memory in protein is specifically responsive to human CMV, and this has been mapped at CUF40. And it's quite specific to one particular peptide, and if you mutate it too far, you lose that response. But in this example, it's extremely impressive and extremely important. This type of memory has really only been clear in mice until this research. Okay, so again, sort of getting back to the type of work that we do, one big question for us was, could we identify these type of cells in non-human primates? Because we want to study them longitudinally and in tissues for the sake of SIP cells. But one thing that we ran into that was a major problem here is that identifying NKG2-positive NK cells is pretty challenging in the past. Because virtually all the antibodies that we use to measure NKG2-positive are human antibodies. And they unfaithfully bind in the past, it's highly greater than that form, and it makes it really difficult to measure them. And again, so this is us trying to track the CMV-specific NKG2-positive cells. So this was never going to work. So basically, I had a very talented postdoc in the lab who spent probably a year developing this based off of the RNA transport platform and the epigenetics. So basically, what this is you have RNA proteins specific to regions of whatever genetic interest you have. And so these are going after NKG2C regions or NKG2A regions. And what's not shown here is you actually end up having blocking proteins as well, which block sequences that may be conserved. And so then you build this lattice. And then now, for the first time, if you've ever been able to be shown in monkey research, is that you can clearly distinguish NKG2A positive NK cells, KLRC1 is a gene, from KLRC2 positive NKG2C NK cells. So now we know that we have this technology that we can use in research. So we needed a real life test to see if this would actually show the expansion of the memory NK cells as we expected. And so what we have here. Cohorts of CMV negative and CMV positive, which is recent CMV. And you look at NKG2A, which is not affected as strongly as CMV cells. You actually see a little bit of a decline in the KLRC1 positive increase in CMV. It's very striking. This is a total increase in our population and a massive shift to NKG2C positivity following transition from CMV negative to CMV positive. It's an interesting trend that we're expecting to see. That once you become infected with CMV, regardless of whether you're a mouse, human, or monkey, you flip the switch to get this NKG2C positive. So, the second type, or the third type of memory NK cell that we've really been investing a lot of energy in is the so called memory like Fc gamma receptor delta G NK cell. Now, these are ones that I refer to that will still require antibodies to maintain the specificity, but they do become much more functional too. It's an original role for these guys in immunotherapy and vaccine strategies. Now, as their name implies, the delta G, they lack gamma chain signal, they lack the gamma signaling chain as well as the adaptive sick. You see the Fc receptor complex here, and this is the gamma signaling chain which they have completely absent. So that's the main distinguishing feature for these cells. And then, as I said, despite this fact, we can still be relatively recalled much more quickly than conventional NK cells, and have much more potent cytokine production, as well as most potent immune functions. But prior to the work that we started doing, it's only been described in human blood. And so we wanted to go in and see what we could find out about these things in research, but perhaps more importantly, figure out what they were doing in tissue. Now, again, this sort of goes back to the same story is, if we evolved in case of CMD as a primary cofactor, again, these guys are massively expanded, much like antigen-specific positive patients, based on CMD-specific positivity. And you can see it here. And this, of course, is relevant to us, since depending on where you are in the world, maybe up to 70% of the population is CMD. So the first thing, just some basics, again, same thing, to re-identify the memory-like deficit in the intake cell population in research in the past. So we take the same strategy, and we can see large family lymphocytes, live dead, negative for CD20, CD13, negative for CD3, expressed in KG2A, and then you can really see them nicely separated here. This is the 6, which is the gamma chain and gamma molecule, and then the gamma chain, which they left. So here you have conventional NK cells, and then very clearly you can see the damage from deficient NK cells that are in the one thing that's also very important about these guys is they also downregulate the transcription factor speleogenomic. Even though I won't go into the institutional biology about that, downregulated speleogenomic tends to be an indicator of alternative development in the liver and seems to be very common in the immune system. So we know that they're really fitting in what we expect. So again, we're looking at a cohort of CMD negative and CMD positive attacks. Do you see the same thing? Absolutely. You can find them in CMD negative attacks. In CMD negative attacks, the ones that are from CMD positive, then you do a nice expansion of these cells. Now, if we look at SIG or SIG infection attacks, we also see an expansion of the dose of the memory like NK cells, but it basically runs in the same line as those we see in CMD. And so what we found, and I won't go through all the data for that, is just that the expansion of these cells, you can see delta G, the function of CMD tighter, it's completely correlated with the shedding and expansion of CMD, and really does not correlate with the expansion of the infection. And I think also most importantly, we use some of the new toys and three colorful concomitant, which you can see that these two cell populations separate out very nicely on the pigment plot and are clearly distinct across the body. So, again, one of the benefits of potentially studying the cell population in monkeys is you can really get a better sense of how they're distributed throughout the body, and you can study them from those tissues. So the first thing to point out, many like delta G and K cells are systemically distributed. You can basically see them anywhere. See them in spleen, bone marrow, certainly find them in the children's tissues, and colon is on here, as well as mesenteries and in this way. And again, sort of an interesting thing is they'll have different tractable patterns than classical and K cells. You see that up here, both from these representative plots as well as here. This is the delta G in red, conventional K cells in blue. Don't express much in terms of CCR7 and 62L as the lymph node homing. But again, this is kind of a common theme of these activated, differentiated NK cells. The delta G expresses higher levels of CCR7, suggesting that they may be circulating in the gut at higher density than the conventional NK cells, which is good for us. And so, even though I said that expansion of the number of delta G is driven by CMD, not by SIG, SIG clearly has an impact on homing as well. Because if you take CMD positive animals and SIG positive animals, you see further upregulation, you've got homing after 47, and then you see an accumulation of these cells in colon at the end of 47. So again, it may not be influenced in numbers, but it certainly seems to redirect where these cells are going. So again, this has been relatively descriptive, this is quite a lot of the system in monkeys. But we know that these guys can have much more functional potency. So a big question for us is what's driving the differences in increased functional brain disease in these populations? So one thing that we started investigating is, well, do this signal gap? Because we know that ligating CD16 keeps off a big signal gap. They have a variety of them happen. But of course, these guys, when you have an immune complex trying to bind to CD16, they don't get any T cells. You don't have the adaptive fix, and you don't have the gamma signature. So this is completely gone. And even if you do a phosphorylation, you look at the delta genes, and you look for phosphorylated 6. Even if it's there, there's no phosphorylation. So these guys, no matter what you stimulate them, they're cross-linking, they're ring complexes, or whatever, they don't use 6. And that's the CD16 gamma chain to say traditional pathway for antibody function. In the conditioning case, where you have two cells that are more functional protein, they don't use this at all. So we started looking at potential alternative signaling pathways to this population. As it turns out, I mean, anyone who's sort of a little bit familiar with the T-cell biology, they know that in T-cells, in addition to signaling through gamma chain 6, can also signal through CD3 beta chain, which is adapted to that 7 in the LC4. But don't be confused by that. It is CD3 beta chain, it is not a T-cell. It is a conserved beta chain that's coming in T-cell. So we wanted to explore the hypothesis that in the absence of this guy, could they really be using this guy? And how is that going to be? And so, if you go on a bit deeper, absolutely, our proposition is completely correct. As you can see here, following CMV infection, which is required to induce the cell, you get a great upregulation of CD3 beta, and more impressively, you get an upregulation of CF70, and you go back and do the same thing as the phospho study. You get really nice upregulation of phosphorylated CD3 beta in following CMV infection. So this is indicating to us that yes, that this is a signaling pathway that these cells can use in the absence of gamma chain and sick. So kind of to digest a little bit to try and make what we think is going on be a little bit clearer. This is sort of the way the CD16 signaling can occur in mice and humans, which also do the primates. So in mice, you have the gamma chain only the heterogamma, you use very little Zap70, and you use much more stuff. Now, T cells are not very good at ADCC in mice, but there's also a difference in probably why this occurs. And it also explains why delta G immunizing T cells don't exist in mice at all. It's a personal difference. Now, in humans, you also have this. A lot of your conventional T cells in humans are benefiting from the virus. But in humans, you can also have the heterodimer complex of CD3 beta and the gamma signaling chain, which equally uses that strategy. Now, what we think is going on in the gene system, and what we have, is these data are really sort of pointing in that direction. And if you abandon even this gene, you homodimerize CD3 beta, and then you use that 70 in the after molecule, and then this is associated with the gene, and you see changes in function. And if you go and you just do a simple ADCC or ICS assay for the conventional and delta G in T cells, and you look at them as CMV negative and CMV positive animals, that's exactly what you see. And this is quite impressive. 107A is a toxic marker, and a toxic production of gamma methane beta. Delta G, you see them as these bars that are virtually non-existent. So that delta G is an immunolactin T cells, until you get exposed to CMV, completely useless. They can't signal, they're small in number, and they can't signal. Once you get CMV positive, they flip on, and then you've got this great new population that homes to the gut and engage antibodies here. You've got a nice effective population for your immune system. Okay, so the last type of memory T cell that I'm going to talk about is what we refer to as the true antigen-specific T cells. These are thought to be germline encoded. They are not against non-native antigens, fully mediated by NK cells, no antibody required, unclear that CMV is necessary for this. But prior to the work we started doing maybe 3 years ago, these had only really been described in mice. And they did some really beautiful work with the non-human lab, originally identifying these, and then also identifying them to use the further receptors. So we wanted to ask the question, do they exist in high-order primates? And if they do, what sort of pathogens actually knock these pathogens off? I think most importantly, as always, what's the mechanism that we give the cells is supposed to be completely removed, all the sort of antigen-specific treatment. So this is, I'll just go through this quickly. This is from the paper we published in Nature Neurology in 2015, which was really the first evidence of an antigen-specific NK cell of any kind induced by SIV and SCIF, as well as vaccine vectors. But this is the first evidence of these antigen-specific NK cells of any type of primate. And so basically what we had done is a memory sensitivity assay when we responded to a pollen cell, and we see very nice killing responses. Are entirely purified antigen-specific NK cell against HIV-19-DNA-Y on the screen. Also see that it's against that as well as on, but not against control peptides. And then I think one of the most impressive things that we found is that it didn't have to be an ongoing infection, which is really unclear when we started doing this. If you take animals that have been vaccinated with ad-26 cells, but never change, these were given genetically. Really nice memory NK cell response in this liver screen, none of that actually fixed, but by comparison, not against the different serotypes at all. So I think this showed us two things. One, vaccines can definitely induce antigen specific memory NK cells, but not all vaccines can induce memory NK cells. So I think since those initial sort of descriptive studies, I think we've gone up a bit, our assays have gotten much more precise. And we've been able to show a number of things. One, we continue to be able to show robust anti-gag responses to SIV and HIV, bald infections, whether this is in treated patients or non-treated patients. One thing that we found is that even though our initial assays were all killing assays, now we developed a multifunctional ICS to measure these two antigen-specific NK. And it turns out that the vast majority of responses are actually cytotoxic in nature as opposed to cytotoxicity. And then another thing that we've been able to do with the IPS is that we can do this proteome scanning of the whole HIV-SIV proteome. And even though there's a lot of noise going on here, we do seem to have some hotspots against the antigen-specific NK cell target in the proteome. And then something that is still early in my lab, but I think is probably one of the more impressive things that we've been able to really demonstrate with this phenomenon. And it's taken a long time to get going. And that is cloning of individual antigen-specific NK cells. So basically what we do is we're storing hundreds of single cell NK cells and screening for the ones that have antigen specificity or that have broad values after we clone them. So the single cell, and then we clone them up and then we test their ability to kill specifically. And so from individual patients, you can see here we've actually been able to isolate a large number of single cells that we've grown up cloning from that have high specificity to HIV GAG. This particular patient, the number of cells that are not responding to CMD that do respond to GAG. And then one thing that we have found that we don't necessarily have an explanation for is that occasionally we'll pull out an NK cell that can respond to more than one pathogen or perhaps more than one peptide or epitope. So this brings up a question of polyspecificity of the memory NK cells, which is a real possibility if we get things that are also doing with the mouse work, because this isn't going to be quite as specific as a T cell and B cell. So polyspecificity would not be outside the memory NK cells. One last thing I want to talk about. I think it was very important for us, based on the work we've done in monkeys in terms of vaccines as well as infections, to really take this into a true HIV vaccine setting and see if we can treat cancer. And so with this, we sponsored, I collaborated with the HCCAN, HIV vaccine trials unit. The first group they did was to test, which has all been blinded, HCCAN-094. Basically, these patients were given GeoVax DNA, plus the MCSF and a variety of proteins, pre-primary administration, and then they were boosted with NDA-expressing GAG poles in the pocket. So this initial study was done in 4 placebos as well as 6 vaccines. I'm sure you got data, which is not being published at this point. And so what we're seeing, I think this is, again, this is one of the most impressive to me, and what we've really been trying to narrow the film so that this is a real thing, is that in the past, we show really potent memory NK cell responses against GAG. little to no response following the prime, which is once again production 107 eggs of electricity. Very little response following the end of prime. You get these great boosts following the NVA boost. Really nice response to further enhance 6 months out. Our vaccines, which you see here in blue and green, are very clear. And from our non-responding to see those, and we go blinded. And again, going back to the ones that I wanted to get home, we seem to be most excited from the disease in the case of the toxicity. Now, a second study that we've done with H15N more recently, again, this is H15N07, where they are being given HIV antigen, plus IL-12DNA, and then they're boosted with RBST HIV. And if you look in the exact same way, you see these memory responses by comparison. This is misleading because it's supposed to be all RBST. But these are the RSV vaccinated patients. If you compare to the NVA study that they showed you on the previous slide, much, much easier. And again, these are primarily cytokine based, but this probably won't be the So before I close, before I close and sum it up, again, just trying to scratch the surface on what's needed in this. So we know that NKG2C is involved. But one thing that we also found using the same ICSL assay is that if we go in and we block NKG2 molecules or if we block the other co-receptor NKG2C4, we can really nicely match killing. And so what we think is probably going on in this response, which is not surprising, based on the some in mice, is that NKG2A and NKG2C are mediating this through their binding of HLA-E, and then NKG2A4, which is an activating receptor, is probably the first. So just to summarize up, really, we gave the first demonstration that immune NK cells could arise specifically against HLA-SLB infection in both humans and non-human candidates. And I think something that just really trying to put the nail on the coffin is that you show these cells can be isolated with a single cell method. So that means you really are pulling out what you think they're getting in these broad areas. These NK adaptive responses can be mounted with multiple types of vaccine, seems to be by Ad26 and NVA, but not necessarily by the summer VSV, and not by FFAP, which we've done that reason in monkeys. Phenotypically, they seem to be relatively conserved between humans and recent attacks. And again, drive us home is that CMV seems to be an innate common cofactor for multiple forms of insulin memory, although not necessarily all that. And then also, finally, I think we're still scratching the surface on that too. Immune cells, they're likely undergoing not only different developmental programs and where and how that they're developed in the body, but also maybe using further signaling mechanisms that are conventional for cells. With that, I'll just close. Thank everyone in my lab, particularly Stanch, putting in everything down around the video in the car, who did most of this work, as well as Stephanie Woods, who's been critical component here. All the funding for their support, and then I also just added a few pictures with the people that actually did all this work, although in these pictures they're not really looking like they're working very hard. So with that, I'll close and take some questions.
So it's a lot of immunology for non-immunology to get through the last few slides that I think are very impactful. And we couldn't get there without the preliminary stuff I understand. But what is really the challenge we have in terms of developing a viable immunology
I think that that's a bigger, broader question beyond NK cells. What would dictate a good HIV vaccine? I personally think it'll be a combination of cellular and antibodies. And I think that NK cells really could make a big contribution here. And it may vary from individual to individual what the NK cell component may be. But I think also something that's important to put out there is that the depth of study that's been put into making T cells and B cells produce what you want them to, or look like what you want them to, has been significant. We're really just beginning to figure out how to tune these antigen-specific T cells. So I think think as we learn more about what receptors are involved, you know, what mechanisms are necessary for this insulin, how do we even think about developing vaccine modalities that produce robust immune responses that don't produce robust T-cell? I think those are the type of questions that we really have to answer before we can dive into that. To determine if there are major components or not. So that's an excellent question that there isn't any answer to. So the only strategy that currently exists would deplete all the immune cells. You can't, at this moment, specifically deplete the memory state. We are looking into potential ways that we could deplete the CFAR-positive population as a way to get at that, but right now it's not perfectly possible. So I'll take that into story. So again, sort of the one thing I've shown previously, published in 2011 by the lead author and Marcus also, they did show that fear persisted in HIV could escape from living. We don't have any evidence at this time whether they could escape from this type of HIV. Now, it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist, and probably it could exist because it should be a social measure. But I think that we just have not been able to do systematic into that question. But I think it's an important question, and does it bring us back exactly where we were? Maybe. But I also think that, you know, the more tools you can have in the toolkit, the more pieces of the arsenal that can contribute, you know, that's how we deal with controlling our conversation. So maybe if you want to clear the virus or protect the virus, you need antibodies, T-cells, and so on, all of the things. I think that the fantastic point is a difficult thing. Because it's certainly clear repertoire, particularly if you sound familiar to match HLA. They appear to work, actually, show that low disease progression also results in some potential weak controllers, although that's probably not the only thing that's pushing to be weak controllers. But we actually think that this system is probably not operating as easy. So it may be something analogous. We really think that the answer is the two molecules with MHCE, and that's sort of what we're exploring now. And so that means we've got to look at, you know, what are the right type of E responses that we want to elicit. And of course, we're trying to do this for birds, which has its own complications. But anyway, but that's the complication, because the evidence that we have, this doesn't seem to be managed by the field. But we do know that CMV infection activates and induces the population of fear. So it could be happening concurrently, but particularly in type 4. I don't think that's the case.
Well, thank you very much for a great grand round. Thank you. There will be no grand round. This is up before, but we'll resume the following. Thank you very much.
Thank you.